introduce myself. I'm editor of Defense Capital Magazine, which is my own magazine, actually. I've been running it for the last 2 years. But before doing this activity, I was a journalist for more than 25 years, working with several newspapers, news agencies, and even foreign media. I have worked for the Press of India, Indo-Asian News Service, which are news wires. And I've also worked for Times of India, Indian Express, and all previously in my career as a journalist. And before I started Defense Capital, I was working for Bloomberg News, which is a American headquartered news wire, which is a global financial news wire, which had a lot of interest in defense business that is happening in South Asia. So I was their defense editor for defense news from the South Asian region, which includes all these countries, neighboring countries. And Kashmir, as you know, is a very important subject, even globally and internationally. So I took a lot of interest in Kashmir issues also. So I can do some analysis. I'm not a great expert in analysis, but yes, national security analysis I do. Risk mitigation analysis is all that I do. And that is a service that I offer through Defense Capital also. And I'm also a practicing advocate. Since I quit journalism full-time, I became a full advocate full-time. And I'm practicing in all the Delhi courts, including the Supreme Court of India, which is based in New Delhi. So that's my small background. Now I'll just move on to my next slide. Okay. So we all know that sometime in October 1947, Kashmir acceded to the independent India. Some of us may know what happened at the time, when the king, Kashmiri king, was an Hindu king. He signed this instrument of accession with the Indian government of that time under Nehru. Sardar Patel was very instrumental in this Kashmir acceding to India. That happened because Kashmir actually wanted to be an independent nation. But Pakistan army sent in some regulars and irregular troops into Jammu Kashmir to capture it, based on which the Kashmir king of the time appealed to India to help. So India put its foot down and said, if you sign the instrument of accession and become one of the states in India, we will help you. To which the instrument of sign was agreed upon. And it was signed based on which India sent its troop to ward off the attack by the Pakistani army regulars and some tribal. They claim that they are tribals, but India believes that most of them who were claimed to be tribal warlords were basically Pakistan army troopers who were posing as tribals. So that was the history that happened. We pushed back the Pakistan army to where the line of actual control today exists, which is along the Poonch axis all the way to Kargil. So that the Poonch axis, we were able to ward off the attack. But unfortunately, most part of Kashmir and Gilgit-Baltistan was still under occupation. Even today, it is under occupation. We call it as Pakistan-occupied Kashmir and Gilgit-Baltistan that we are aware of. This is slightly just to give you a bit of an history about this. Okay, so we'll come to the main topic of the day, which is Article 370. It was scrapped on August 5th of 2019. We all know about it. It's almost nearly 2 years since the scrapping of Article 370. I believe most of you know what is Article 370, and I mean, needn't have to go into it. If you have any doubts, I think we can still take it up in the question answer session. Basically, to give you a brief idea of what is Article 370, Article 370 was a special provision that was introduced into the Constitution of India when it was adopted in 1950, where Article 370 was a temporary provision which was to be scrapped even before the Constituent Assembly of the Jammu Kashmir state completed its task. The Article 370 provides for certain concessions to Jammu and Kashmir state to become part of the Indian Union. The concession, one of the main concessions was that it would have its own constitution, it would have its own flag, and most of the Indian laws will not be applicable to Jammu and Kashmir state, and Jammu and Kashmir state will have an assembly which will basically approve each of the legislation that the Indian parliament enacts. Only then it can become a law in Jammu and Kashmir. So that was the condition. Probably we all might know that Indian penal code was not applicable to Jammu and Kashmir. They had a separate penal code of their own until this Article 370 was scrapped. So under Article 370, it also provides the powers to the President of India to introduce resolutions that will be applicable to Jammu and Kashmir. That is Article 335A is the provision that provides that power, under which several actions were taken by Jammu and Kashmir Assembly, which included denying right to property to women of Jammu and Kashmir who go and marry people outside Kashmir. Basically, if you marry a non-Kashmiri, say from Delhi or say from Ambala or from Chandigarh, the women will lose
her.
Whereas a Pakistani male, Kashmiri male, even if he marries a Pakistani woman, that man would still continue to enjoy the properties of property in Jammu and Kashmir. So basically, that was one of the injustices done to the women in Kashmir. And also one more thing was that the reservations for SCST category and OBC was never applied to Jammu and Kashmir as enacted by the Parliament of India. Jammu and Kashmir had its own reservation policy under which several Dalits were affected because of this. So this was another injustice that was committed, perpetrated by Article 370. This also ensured that a few family members of the ruling class in Jammu and Kashmir enjoyed unbridled powers, and they could take away most of the assistance, financial assistance that the Indian government provided to the people of Kashmir, and they enjoyed lots of comfort, whereas the common man in Jammu and Kashmir suffered. So this is basic background about Article 370. And the demand for scrapping of 370 has existed since 1950 when the constitution got enacted, was passed. But unfortunately, no government, previous government in the last 72 years had the temerity or the will to scrap it. Though it was clearly mentioned in the constitution that it's a temporary provision, that is up to the constituent assembly existed for Jammu and Kashmir state. It also provided for a separate constitution for Jammu and Kashmir. These were all some of the injustices that were perpetrated. Special status that provided autonomy. Everybody claims that it's an autonomy, but it's actually an injustice to other states in the country. There was a demand for Jammu and Kashmir to be on par with other states, which this government in 2019. The second Narendra Modi government had the guts to scrap. Basically, scrap is a very colloquial term that I'm using, but actually it's not scrapping. It is an amendment that was brought in. The amendment actually made Article 370 powerless. That is what happened. That provision is basically called as Article 367, which empowered the president to amend this particular Article 370, based on which this amendment was done. There are a bit of a controversy on that. There are legal questions that are asked. Supreme Court is currently seized of this matter. So since it's currently under a litigation, I'm not going to be talking about it. The controversy that exists regarding Article 370. Maybe in question answer session, if anybody has a clarification you require, I'll be more than happy to take up and answer that question. So this is about the background to Article 370 scrapping or abolition, basically. So this is the map of Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh, just for your understanding, because there are a lot of maps that are doing rounds, which are actually not correct. So just to give you an example, you see a map here. Are you able to see the map?
Yes,
we are.
Great. Okay. So if you see the green, the light green part of the map is the Ladakh area. Interestingly, what the Narendra Modi government has done, particularly Amit Shah's brain, is that they included Gilgit-Baltistan, which is this part of the... Are you able to see the cursor? Are you able to see my cursor, Sendhil?
No, Ji. No, it is not.
No,
cursor. Okay, fine. So, the northern part of that yellow, light green map is basically Gilgit-Baltistan. If you see, you can read this Indus River in that area, right? So that area is basically the Gilgit-Baltistan area. So you see Kargil here, right? So the Kargil area is where the yellow sea lies. Slightly northeast, the yellow sea lies at this point in time. So that was a very interesting move by the Narendra Modi government to include Gilgit-Baltistan in Ladakh Union Territory, whereas the white portion is the Jammu and Kashmir territory, which includes the Pakistan-occupied Kashmir also, just for your information. The Jhelum River, which you see on the map, is the border with the Pakistan that exists today. So that is the map. So as per the Indian government's map, the red lines that you see is the international boundary, and slightly above Himachal, you see the state boundary between Jammu and Kashmir, Ladakh and Himachal Pradesh, and also a bit of Punjab. Ravi River is basically the border boundary for Jammu and Kashmir and Punjab area. Just this is for your slight understanding. I have also slightly ensured that Kargil is seen separately. I have a reason to put it there because it is a headache area for as far as India is concerned, in terms of, we all know about the Kargil War of 1999. Look at the road, yellow colored road that is going via Dras, Kargil, up to Leh. That area is very important because it's very close to the line of actual line of control there. And the Pakistan army troopers had occupied those heights there, Dras and Kargil. And we had to vacate them, and we had a huge loss in terms of our soldiers there in 1999. You all must have heard about it. I'm sure most of you were already born at that time. So you might have heard about it, or even later you might have heard about it, just to give you that slight information, and marked it that way. Okay, so this is currently the present holding or influence or control or administrative areas of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh, just for you to understand that difference. You see this dark yellow portion is Akshay Chin on the extreme right. That part of Akshay Chin, which is actually part of Ladakh, is currently held by China. That is just to demarcate. Line of actual control is also marked there. So line of actual control is the place where the Indian Army and the Chinese army are currently facing off in Ladakh. They have a confrontation and conflict that is happening in that area. So I'll come back to this map a little later when I explain some of the challenges that we have. So you also, in the northern part of, you see another small dark yellowish area called the Saksham Valley. That is an area that was originally occupied by Pakistan in 1947-48 during that war to liberate Kashmir. And it was ceded to China when China wanted to build a highway, super highway that passes via Akshay Chin and Saksham Valley down Gilgit-Baltistan all the way to Pakistan's Arabian Sea port. So that is why Saksham Valley has become a very important area for us. Just below Saksham Valley is Siachen Glacier that you see. Siachen Glacier is another huge conflict point, and there is a problem there. That is one of the challenges that I will be highlighting when I come back to this map at a later part of the presentation. So then you see Gilgit-Baltistan, which is marked slightly with a different purple color. light purple color. And below that you see the Pakistan occupied Kashmir in slightly darker purple color. Then you see Kashmir Valley in violet and Jammu and Kashmir in orange, Jammu in orange color and Kashmir in violet color, with Srinagar headquarters and Jammu, Leh, Kargil and all clearly marked. Muzaffarabad, which is actually currently held by Pakistan occupied Kashmir, is also seen on the map. So this is the map that you need to understand how it's currently divided. So Poonch is exactly on the line of actual control. Line of actual control is a de facto border area at this point in time, where the Indian Army troops are defending the Indian territory. Beyond that is Azad Kashmir to the left, as Pakistan calls it. We call it as Pakistan occupied Kashmir. I mentioned it here because just to make you understand what is Pakistan's so-called Azad Kashmir. So that is the area that is currently held by them. So this is again, you can see it. Okay, so we can come back. If you have any doubts, you can always ask me, make a note of it and ask me after I made the presentation. Okay, so this is again slightly different map, basically to show you the entire lot of area which is currently under Pakistan occupation. So the extreme left, light blue colored area is completely under the control of Pakistan at this point in time. Jammu Kashmir, we see that Ladakh, at present we have only this much of control over Ladakh areas, Union Territory of Ladakh. So this is again for information purposes. Okay, so this is a topic that has been chosen. I've divided it into three subcategories, and I'll be dealing with each one of them one by one. So first challenge that we have is domestic politics. In domestic politics, after Article 370 was scrapped, what has happened is that we all know that most of the political leaders of Jammu and Kashmir were put behind bars. Basically, they were put under house arrest. Technically, it's not an house arrest. Basically, it is a detention, actually. But for colloquial language's sake, we call it as house arrest, because they were all confined to their houses. They were detained in their houses and not allowed to get out of their house. So this happened, and they were all under detention for almost a year. Around 223 people were kept under this detention for a long time. But they were released after most of them, almost 150 or 160 of them, were released within 2 months of this Article 370 scrapping. So, you know, many people say that, oh, a whole lot of political leaders were put behind bars. That is not correct. Most of them were left off in 2 months. Only about, I think about 40 or 50 of them were, 40-50 of them were still kept under detention for till 2020. But in the early part of 2020, most of them were released. And only a handful of political leaders, like say Mehbooba Mufti or Farooq Abdullah and his son Omar Abdullah, were kept under house arrest or detention. I don't want to call it as house arrest, because the government itself has clarified that it was not an house arrest. So they were detained, basically. Preventive detention is what the term that they have used. So they were kept under detention, and even they were all released one by one soon after this COVID situation happened in early 2020, April, May. By May, all of them were released from their detention. So after that, what happened was, sometime in August, all these leaders came back together to oppose this Article 370 scrapping under, on one stage, basically, on one platform. So that meeting happened in the residence of Farooq Abdullah in Srinagar. And the road on which this particular house, residence of Farooq Abdullah, exists is called Gupkar Road. That is why this name, Gupkar Alliance. Gupkar is nothing but the name of the road on which Farooq Abdullah's residence is located. Yeah. Just for your understanding's sake, I'm mentioning this. So they all met on August 4th, 2019. First, they met in 2019 at that time, most of them were, some of them were under, August 2020, and most of them were already released from detention. So that is when they decided to pass a resolution stating that they will all come together to oppose this Article 370 scrapping. 2 months hence, sometime I think October 15th, this alliance, they met again, and at that time they announced this political alliance for Gupkar declaration. So Gupkar declaration is the one that was done on August 4th, 2020 that I mentioned. So there they are declared to revert back to Article 370 when they come back to power in the center. That is what they have done, and that they will fight against this scrapping, and they will work for it. This is basically a huge development that happened in domestic politics, because this is the first time that all the political parties of the Jammu and Kashmir had come together on one platform, except for the Bharatiya Janata Party, which is the ruling party in the center. So all the opposition parties in Jammu and Kashmir came together. So it is a huge challenge. Why I see it as a challenge is because, you know, if all these parties fight the election together, then it is quite possible that BJP may not get any presence in that state, political presence in that state. And that would in turn, you know, create a momentum for political calls that are already happening, like what Senthil mentioned just now. Digvijay Singh has announced that if the Congress and the UPA come back to power, they will revert back to the Article 370 clause in the, I mean, article in the Constitution, thereby reintroducing a separate constitution, a separate flag and all that in Kashmir, and you know, thereby ensuring that this integration of Jammu and Kashmir into the Union of India is reversed. So that's the plan that they have. That is why it's a huge challenge, and it's an issue that we need to closely watch at this point in time. So the one more thing is, this Gupkar Alliance did really well in the District Development Council elections that were held in Jammu and Kashmir. In about 20 districts, polling happened. And this particular alliance, Gupkar Alliance, they fought as an alliance. They contested, you know, they had a good understanding locally in terms of electoral politics. And they did really well. They won a lot of seats. In fact, BJP also won a lot of seats in this particular elections that happened. Just that's just a background information that we need to keep in mind. So I have a reason for mentioning it, because I'll go back and refer to it at some stage when I talk about political assassinations that are going on currently in Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, see, the other biggest development issue and challenge that I see is the political boycott call that has been going on. So a lot of you might have heard of this Huriyat conference, which is basically a separatist movement in Jammu and Kashmir. They want a separate nation, state of Kashmir, in fact. And one half of that Huriyat conference is pro-Pakistan, and one half is for separate independent Kashmir. So there's a divide within Huriyat also, but that divide is basically not so pronounced that we can take, you know, solace over that division. But otherwise, what has happened is the separatist faction belonging to Syed Ali Shah Gilani, who is basically the former chairman of Huriyat Conference. He has had a fallout with the Huriyat Conference at this point in time, but still he is a very powerful and influential separatist leader in Jammu and Kashmir. He called for a boycott of the elections that happened in the last 2 years. Yes, always called for you know, a boycott. So, if but unfortunately for India, the DDC elections that happened had a very strong polling that happened. Almost 75% polls, polling of votes happened in the election, which is a very positive sign. But nevertheless, there is a threat from this poll boycott calls. Why I say this is, if suppose say elections do not get a good response from the electorate at some point in time in the future, and if the voting percentage decreases drastically, like it had happened in previous elections, when there were only 2% or 3% votes in Jammu and Kashmir assembly elections. So when, if such a situation happens, then the entire democratic exercise and promotion of democracy that India has been doing in the state of Jammu and Kashmir will fall flat, and there will be calls for, you know, this will be used by forces inimical to India as a campaign tool and a propaganda tool against India in Jammu and Kashmir and abroad, using it abroad to create a political pressure on India, global pressure on India. So that is why it's a challenge. So that we need to watch out for. So political assassinations, as I said, these political assassinations are a recent trend that we are witnessing. Pakistan-inspired terrorist groups are shooting down and killing, hacking to death political leaders in the grassroots level in Jammu and Kashmir these days. Just 2-3 days back, you must have heard or read about Rakesh Pandit, who was a municipal councillor in Tral in Pulwama district, was shot down and was gunned down by a terrorist group. So a lot of terrorist groups are currently acting on Pakistan-inspired effort to eliminate democratically elected leaders at the grassroots level, thereby subverting the democratic process that has happened in the recent times in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. So not just BJP leaders, even Muslim, Rakesh Pandit is a Hindu, Kashmiri Hindu, but there are Kashmiri Muslims also who have been elected representatives who are sarpanches and panches in Kashmir's panchayat system, and municipal councillors, DDC members or from all political parties are being killed by these terror groups. Basically, people whom they find to be a bit of discomfort for their political stand of separating from India. So these people are being eliminated by the use of terror groups. So Anisul Ghani was another important leader who was gunned down in the recent months. Again, a Muslim leader, local leader in Anantnag district. He was a candidate in the DDC polls. He was killed. And the numbers are huge. At least from what I've observed in the last, since January this year, there have been at least a dozen political killings that have happened, assassinations that have happened, which is quite a huge number. This kind of assassination of political leaders has never happened in Jammu and Kashmir before. You have had the assassination of Kashmiri Pandit leaders. Even Pandit, symbolic killings of leaders of Kashmiri Pandit community, but not political leaders who are including Muslim leaders. So that's a new trend that has happened, which is a huge challenge that we need to watch out for. So I will just move on to the assembly reorganization challenge that we have. So as you all know, Jammu and Kashmir is now a union territory with an assembly, whereas Ladakh is a union territory without assembly. Just to give you the small how it is different, Ladakh is like Andaman and Nicobar Islands, and with one member of parliament there and no assembly. Whereas Jammu and Kashmir is like Pondicherry, where you have an assembly which elects MLAs who have powers of legislation in the assembly. So that is the difference between Ladakh and Jammu and Kashmir as union territories. So currently, in the previous state assembly of Jammu and Kashmir, which included Ladakh, prior to August 2019, there were 114 assembly seats in that assembly, state assembly, where 24 of the seats were reserved for constituencies that are currently held by Pakistan, in Pakistan, Kuwait, Kashmir and Gilgit-Baltistan. So 24 seats were allotted there. So that those seats were never held elections till date. because it's under Pakistan occupation, but still those seats were kept vacant. So effectively, the strength of the State Assembly of Jammu and Kashmir prior to 2019 was just 19 seats. So out of which, 46 were in the Kashmir region and 44 were in the Jammu region, Jammu and Ladakh region. Ladakh had about 7 seats. So effectively 37 seats in Jammu region. That was the original, that is how it was constituted, the State Assembly. But after this 2019 Article 370 scrapping, the assembly has been announced, though there is no indication of when the election will be held. Probably the government, central government, is waiting for a conducive atmosphere there before this election can be held. But what has happened was that the assembly delimitation process might also take place based on the 2011 census. If that happens, then it is quite possible that Jammu might have more number of seats in the assembly, which will again be 114 seats total when the reorganized Union Territory Assembly is elected. They will again have 114 seats with an increase in the number of seats in both Kashmir and Jammu region. But the interesting thing is there is just a political discussion that is happening. There is no concrete decision in this regard as far as delimitation is concerned. The decision is yet to be taken. But the buzz on the ground is that if the delimitation happens, Jammu will have a higher number of assembly seats than Kashmir region based on the 2011 census. If that happens, then the political discussion in Jammu and Kashmir will have repercussions. There will be repercussions and ripples will be there, because till date, Kashmir has been a dominant factor in the State Assembly. Politicians from Kashmir were a dominant factor because they could win more number of seats from the Kashmir region, based on which the Kashmir was more powerful, region was more powerful in the state. So that might change. So that is where the political challenge lies, where you might find some unrest because of this in the Kashmir region. So that we have to watch out for. This is basically the first issue, domestic politics, that I could present to you. Now I'll move on to the second subtopic that I decided, which is Pakistan. If all said and done, Pakistan is a major factor in Jammu and Kashmir, primarily because Pakistan, has attempted to capture the Kashmir region from India at some point in time. And one of the major reasons for conflict between India and Pakistan is Kashmir. They have fought 4 wars till date. And all 4 of them, at least 3 of them were for Kashmir. One of them was 1971 war when Bangladesh was created. But they have fought at least 3 wars till date, including the Kargil battle, which was basically for the state of, on the issue of Kashmir. So that is why Pakistan is a major issue here. And the biggest challenge that we have is that Pakistan continues to follow terrorism as a state policy even today. And they have not given up. Basically, what happened was they could not win India in a conventional war with their army, air force and navy. So they decided to do an unconventional war, which is using terrorism as a state policy to target India and to weaken the Indian state's hold, control, administration and power in Jammu and Kashmir state. So we have had lots and lots of attacks that have happened. We all know about it. But these terror attacks, even now terror attacks happen, but they are in a lower scale. Prior to 2019, we might have heard about the big terror attacks that happened in Uri and Pulwama, to which India responded back with a surgical strike in 2016 and a aerial strike in Balakot in 2019 February. So this is why Pakistan becomes an important challenge and an issue in in Pakistan, in Jammu and Kashmir, and there have been a lot of terror attacks in the recent times. But as I told you, they're all minor attacks, including the one on that happened on some of our, CRPF troopers in the recent times in Pulwama district and all. So this is something that we need to watch out for. The other big challenge that we have is that Pakistan indulges in huge global propaganda against India in around the world in several countries. So as for, I mean, with regard to the terrorism, I just want to mention that in the latest report from the army that I've received is that there are around 400 terrorists who are waiting in terror camps that Pakistan Army's inter-services intelligence, the tri-services intelligence secret agency, who carry out covert operations. They are training about 400 terrorists at this point in time to infiltrate into India. That is one small information that I want to share, because of which there might be a spike in terror attacks in the next few months. That is a possibility. So most of these 400 people get eliminated as they enter India via the line of actual control, the gaps that are there, the holes that are there in the border security. But still, at least more than half of these number infiltrate into India and they carry out terror attacks, which is a huge challenge, as I mentioned earlier. Global propaganda that I touched upon, we should understand that Pakistan hires lobby and propaganda agencies abroad to launch and continue with a huge campaign against India. You must have heard of Pakistan hiring at least half a dozen lobbying groups in the United States to work against India, to campaign against India. So these lobby firms have a huge influence in the US Congress, with the Congress members and the representatives in the US Congress. So there is a huge Pakistan caucus of congressmen in the US today, and it's a very powerful lobby within the US Congress. So congressmen usually and representatives, they are part of this caucus, and they voice in favor of Pakistan in Congress meetings. They also shape policy and resolutions and laws in favor of Pakistan in the US Congress. So this recently we had one Indian origin congressman called as Ro Khanna, who joined this Pakistan caucus, which created a huge ruckus in among the Indian community in US. Around 220 Indian organizations which are based in US, they wrote a huge mail and letters to Ro Khanna to withdraw from the Pakistan caucus, but he refused to do so. So what I mean to say is that the lobby firms and these lobbyists and propaganda unit in the US in favor of Pakistan is quite effective and powerful, and it could sway even Indian origin congressmen to their favor. So similar effort is also happening in the European Union Parliament today and among nations, other nations around the world. The main focus of this propaganda is on Jammu and Kashmir. They project Indian government of committing human rights violations, Indian army raping women in Kashmir. I mean, these kind of false information is being spread, and propaganda is being carried out by these lobby firms and all these members of parliament and all. So just before the Biden administration came to power, while Trump was still president, you must have heard of the visit of Indian External Affairs Minister S. Jaishankar, Dr. S. Jaishankar, to the US, when a couple of Indian origin congressmen, congresswomen, tried to forcibly enter into a meeting that he was holding in the US Congress premises in the Capitol Hill, and Jai Shankar refused to talk to them. That became a huge controversy. That includes the current Vice President of the US, Kamala Harris. There is a slight echo. Is it possible for everybody to switch off their mics so that there is no disturbance for others to listen to, please? Thank you. Okay, so the another issue that I want to highlight is about peace talks between India and Pakistan. It always gets stuck over two issues. One is terrorism as a state policy, which is again perpetrated in Jammu and Kashmir. And the second issue is Kashmir itself. So Pakistan keeps mentioning that the K word is the primary, K word is Kashmir, is primary issue between India and Pakistan. And unless Kashmir issue is resolved, there cannot be peace between India and Pakistan. This is being repeated by Pakistan quite frequently, because of which the peace talks cannot happen between India and Pakistan. So that is another huge challenge that we have. So that is again something that we need to watch out for. So one more, the largest issue that we have is Islam. This is the elephant in the room that I mentioned. Just because the Kashmir population is Muslim majority, Pakistan is able to sway their mindset with the use of sermons in the mosque and other religious calls that happen from their mosque in Kashmir. They're able to influence the mindset of the people there and turn them against India. So this is again a huge challenge that we have. This is something I believe there is no solution to it unless there is some kind of direct intervention in terms of convincing the religious leaders of these mosques to be on the side of India and the benefit of being on the side of India. So that probably is the only solution that we have with regard to the fourth issue that I want to highlight. So this is the last slide that I have. So we'll complete it in another 5-10 minutes and we can have Q&A if everybody is willing to do it. Okay, so with China, what is the biggest issue there is that first and foremost, we have a undecided border with China in Jammu and Kashmir, Ladakh region, basically Ladakh region. That is called as the line of actual control, where we all know that since May last year, there has been a huge military conflict that is going on between the two sides. There are certain places where India has an advantage along the line of actual control, and there are certain other areas where China has an advantage, the communist China has an advantage. So this is where I just want to go back to my that maps to explain to you certain things which you will be interested in knowing. Okay, so this is a good map that we can handle. Okay, so you see the line of actual control here. See, the northern part of line of actual control, where the letters line is written, that area is called as Depsang Plains. So that is a very weak point for as far as India is concerned. The middle place where actual is written is where the Galwan Valley is, where on June 15, there was a clash between the Indian and Chinese troopers where India lost 20 of its soldiers, including the commanding officer of the unit. There was an Indian, Tamilian soldier also among the dead. We all must have heard of it. He comes from somewhere near Madurai, hails from that place. He was killed in that attack that happened. So that is, Galwan Valley is the place where the actual word is written in the along the line of actual control. And down below is, we have this region called as Gogra area, Hot Springs in Gogra. That is somewhere near, below the letter K in Ladakh. Ladakh letter K, that is the area where that Hot Spring and Gogra area is. So currently what has happened is sometime early this year, I think January, February, the Galwan Valley conflict and the Pangangso Lake area conflict was resolved. We all know it. The troops have gone back from those areas. That those two areas are actually in the location where the actual word is written on the map, if you can see in Nakhchivan area. So there, the what has happened is in at present there is peace prevailing in that area, but where we have problem is in the area where Diksam Plains is, where the line word is written, and in Gogra Hot Spring area where K is written, Ladakh letter K is written. So those two areas are the problem areas at this point. Why are these problem areas? Because the Gogra and Hot Spring area is where India has much more greater advantage in terms of terrain, whereas China don't have an advantage. So there they are putting a lot of pressure on Indian troops there in that area. Whereas line, which is Diksang Plain, which I mentioned, is a weak point for India, where China has an advantage. They have full strength of army tanks, artillery guns and soldiers currently located in that area. Why it is a danger area? See, look at Siachen, where Siachen is. If Chinese troops make a push from Diksang Plains in the location where line is written and cross that line of actual control, they join up in a place where Jammu U is written, they can cut off Siachen glacier too easily for India. The land access can be denied to India to reach Siachen glacier. So that is where the problem lies. That is a huge strategic disadvantage for India, which makes India quite concerned at this point in time. So this is what I wanted to explain in the map for you. I hope you understood it. And the other area is Sachem Valley. If say the Chinese troops line up from from this region all the way up to Sachem Valley, that is quite easily possible, because currently Gilgit Baltistan is under Pakistan control. And why is China quite concerned or interested in having a military conflict in that area is that as I mentioned earlier, their national transnational highway passes via Aksaichin through the Chinese territory of Xinjiang, and through Sachem Valley it goes all the way down to the Arabian Sea. So that is a huge area of interest for China. So that is where they are willing to do a conflict in the Ladakh region with India. So this is what I wanted to explain as a challenge. Okay. So military conflict I've already explained along with the line of actual control situation. So the third issue challenge is the global power ambitions of China. See, the since China wants to become the numero uno of the world, and it is trying to dislodge the US as the most powerful nation in the world, it wants to teach a lesson to all the nations that are capable of challenging China in the region. That is why you see problem all the way from Japan to South Korea to Vietnam to Thailand the Indian subcontinent. So you find the challenges that are existing, and because of which China is putting pressure on Taiwan, it is putting pressure on Japan, it's putting pressure on, and it is also putting pressure on India in the Ladakh and Arunachal Pradesh regions. Arunachal, as you know, is claimed completely by China. So the other strategy that it is adopting against India is the string of pearls strategy, by creating naval bases in countries that are India's neighbors, like Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Pakistan. See, the other area of conflict that is likely with China is in Afghanistan. So that is an emerging conflict, maybe a different topic that we need to take up at a different time. So because of China's power ambitions, global power ambitions, it is causing trouble for India in Ladakh. So the last but not the least is the Chinese expansionism, which I mentioned about. They want to expand their area of influence. They have occupied Xinjiang, which was originally called as East Turkestan, Tibet, southern Mongolia has been occupied. Manchuria has been occupied by China. So it just wants to expand its territorial borders. And it is also targeting Sikkim, Arunachal Pradesh and Ladakh as Mao Zedong had mentioned that it is the fingers. Tibet is the palm and Sikkim, Arunachal, Ladakh are all the fingers of that palm. So they want to occupy these territory and Ladakh is one of their primary areas of interest. So my last statement would be that China has still date not accepted the scrapping of Article 370 of the Indian Constitution. It says that India, since Ladakh is its own territory, India does not have a locus standi in Ladakh. That is their claim, which obviously India is countering in its own way. It has a claim over Aksai Chin, which is currently under Chinese occupation. And Tibet is a major weak point for China, but unfortunately the Indian government has conceded the Tibet to be part of China under the One China policy sometime in 2003, when we got Sikkim, China to accept Sikkim as one of India's states. So, but that give and take has not worked out well for India. So, the other biggest challenge that I mentioned was the collusion that China can and Pakistan can have, and they can militarily create troubles for India when there is a simultaneous two-front attack that can happen, which I already explained to you when I discussed that map, Siachen Glacier map that I discussed with you. So these are the issues that we have. So I think I've completed my presentation. Let me just stop my sharing and then we can take up questions if you have any, and also maybe a discussion. Yes. Thank you so much. If you have any questions, you can ask. I think I've already taken about an hour to make my presentation. So,
Namaste. Very good presentation. Also excellent. Brahmindraji.
Thank you. Yeah, I can identify you. Thank you.
Yes.
Excellent.
It was really nice presentation, sir.
Thank you.
As people from outside, really we did not aware about this much detail. And the encouraging news is the population as per the new census population 2011, Jammu may get more MLA constituencies. That is a good news. My question is, on seeing the Balochistan, you showed the map, the Pakistan occupied Kashmir. The geographic area looks like bigger than both Kashmir and Jammu. Like that, the geographical area gives more. What is the population of that POK? That is my question.
See, POK.
Any idea? Any guess?
Yes. Let me just explain to you. POK is only a very small area. When you add Gilgit-Baltistan to POK, then it looks like a large area. Gilgit-Baltistan is a separate, province entirely when it was originally part of the British Empire. So Gilgit-Baltistan was a separate state at one point of time. So only for administrative purposes, it was never actually under the Kashmiri king, just for your information's sake. So that is the only difference. It was actually under the British Empire.
Okay, so
if you asked about population, you asked about population, right? So let me just give you the population figure. One second, just hold on.
In the meantime, I will add one more question. Yeah. So Balochistan is not part of Pakistan territory at the time of partition. And what is the status of neither India nor Pakistan at the time of partition?
Correct. Balochistan was just like Jammu and Kashmir. It had not joined India when we attained independence. So, but Balochistan wanted to be a separate nation. But it was occupied by Pakistan later. That's what happened.
Okay. It would have, same would have happened in Kashmir also if Kashmir remained as a separate nation. Correct. I think
if Kashmir had not signed the instrument of accession with India, the same fate would have happened to Kashmir also. That's a fact. One second, I'm just finding that population figure that you asked.
It's
me.
Okay, it's okay. If data is not ready, need not to worry. Other questions.
It is there. It is there with me. I have prepared a major report on Jammu and Kashmir and Pakistan occupation. It is there, that, but I'm not able to recall immediately. So that is why I'll let you know. Jay. I'll let you know later. Huh? I'm not able to recall immediately.
This is
fine, Jay, please.
What is the implication of Indus Water Treaty on this? It has any on that?
Indus Water Treaty, basically, if you look at it, we have conceded a lot in the Indus Well River Treaty to Pakistan in terms of giving them water, free access to water there. So, whether India will go ahead and go back on the treaty, that I doubt. For humanitarian considerations, India may not do it, but it is the last instrument of war if we do that. So, if there is a war that breaks out, and if you really want to squeeze Pakistan at some point, then we may break that treaty and stop water. This noise was made by the Indian government representatives. Some of the ministers did make a noise over it, but that was just a noise. It was not serious, I think. So that is about the treaty.
Iran, Chabahar port.
Yeah.
What is the implication post Article 370? They have withdrawn something, then again they were asking us to start the project. So what exactly happening there? Any specific particular area, Chabahar port? At the top, also it was, as you said, string of pearl policy.
String of pearls, yeah.
They are made it that Hamad the top port also it had rent out to China, and we left over that Chabahar port also. What exact?
Chabahar port is in Iran. The Godar port is in Pakistan.
Yeah, understood.
So Godar port is where the Chinese transnational highway comes and links up all the way from Gilgit Baltistan right down through Baluchistan. It goes and links up with the Godar port, which is near Karachi. So what is the implication of the Chabahar port? Article 370 doesn't have any implication on Chabahar port project that India was doing for Iran. But there were some Chinese interference that had happened in Chabahar port. China offered to do the work from, if India is ousted from that project. But however, I think that plan of China didn't work out. So India is still in the game as far as Chabahar port is concerned at this point in time. We are in talks with them to continue with the project.
Okay. Gangadharanji, any other question?
I can see Sumitya also here. Namaste. Yes, anybody has any other question, then please let me know.
Akka, Sumadhi Akka?
You are on mute, Akka.
Sir, good evening, sir. Please explain the what kind of political that took place after the abrogation of Article 370 in
Dr. Brahmaya, sorry, I could not hear your question clearly because there is some disturbance. Your voice is cracking. Did anybody else?
My voice is okay, sir.
Now it is fine, please.
After abrogation of Article 370, so what kind of political developments have taken place in Jammu and Kashmir, sir?
I mentioned about it. My first part of the presentation was that. So we have had detention of political leaders that have happened for a long while. Almost for a year, some senior leaders were there. Not all of them were detained for 1 year, but leaders like... Yeah, they were there. But after that, the Gupkar Alliance has been formed. So I had explained why it is a problem for India. That also I had explained in the first part.
Bipinji, actually, you mentioned about that resettlement of pandits in Jammu and Kashmir. Development in the sense of how they are now settling over there. What is the job opportunity or anything? Government is having any separate plan for that?
No, Ji. That resettlement is not happening as we think. See, there is still a problem for pandits to go back and settle there. The threat to their life continues. Please understand this. The political leaders, locally, democratically elected political leaders are being killed. Like the municipal councillors and the panchas and sarpanchas are being killed. So how do you think pandits will go and settle there when such a mahol prevails? The previous governments have, the state governments, when it was still a state, they have made a whole lot of promises about resettlement, promising jobs and all that. But that has not worked out. That has not worked out till date. And it is not likely to work out for a very long time to come. Till the time you have this terror threat, threat of elimination, assassinations, that is not going to happen. People have lost too many lives. Nobody is going to risk their lives anymore.
So still in out of control, right?
The situation is still out of control. Only thing is you don't have too many incidents that are happening. But you loosen the grip on the districts, the problem will flare up again. Like what is happening in Punjab. In Punjab, you loosen up a little bit of security setup. Now again, there is talk of Khalistan and separatism and all that in Punjab. So that kind of a situation will happen. You must have heard what happened in the Golden Temple in Amritsar just 3-4 days back. They went and raised Khalistan slogan inside. It was Blue Star Operations' anniversary. They went and raised Khalistan slogan. It was completely jam-packed. That Golden Temple was completely jam-packed and they very freely raised Khalistan slogans. Even today, the priest in Golden Temple, they support the Khalistan movement. So though they are, part of the SGPC, which is elected by the Indian community, Sikh community, they support Khalistan. So if you loosen grip in the Kashmir districts in Jammu and Kashmir, everything will be lost again. So that is why military grip needs to continue, and that will only maintain peace there at this point in time. See, I have not mentioned the Kashmiri funded resettlement as one of the challenges because it is impossible. It is not a practical issue, basically. It's not possible. It's an impossible task. That is why I left it out. I only talked about the present day challenge that exists.
See, actually, government promised that thing. They are resettling pandits over there, right?
Yeah, the state governments have promised.
Prior to Article 370 removal, talking about that thing, pandit can be resettled over there and interaction with India, everything will be in proper manner. That's what they said. Anything they achieved as of now?
Nothing has been achieved. Nothing has been achieved and it is impossible. It is impossible in this particular atmosphere in Kashmir. See, please let us...
What way we can achieve in that?
You can't achieve anything at this point in time unless... the mindset is changed. I mentioned about it earlier. The mosques are used for campaign against India. unless the Maulvis and Maulanas in the mosques are convinced to talk in favor of India, you will continue to have this challenge. Pandits cannot go and settle there.
Okay.
So, yeah, Gandhi, Sumati Akka was asking a question.
Pandits vandu, even I heard that they themselves, they are not willing to go back to again original place. Is that true? One thing. And one more thing, avangalukkuriya and the land, veed edhume kadaiyadhu. They don't have any immovable property there.
Actually, as far as pandits are concerned, as I mentioned, they will not risk their life. So yeah, they are not willing. That is a fact.
Yeah, they are not willing.
They are not willing to go back because they know the threat exists. The threat continues even though there are less number of terror incidents that are happening since 2019. Still, the threat exists. So if they go, there will be a clash. There will be an attack. And the Kashmiri Pandit people are not prepared to fight at this point in time because they are not trained to fight. The terrorists are trained to fight, trained to attack by Pakistan. But India does not provide such a training to Kashmiri Pandits to go and defend themselves. So that is a real problem. The other issue is of settling some former military men in Kashmir. That is again will become a hot potato, political hot potato, if you do that. So that is also not a solution. So the only solution that I see is having engaging in dialogue with the religious leaders in Kashmir area and changing their mindset to accept the people from Jammu Kashmir, Kashmiri Pandit people to be settled back in Kashmir. That is the only solution. But at this point in time, the Pandits are not willing to trust any of the Maulvis and Maulanas. That is the problem. Anji, anything else?
இன்னொரு விஷயம், இந்த ஆர்டிகல் 370 அபாலிஷ் பண்ணதுக்கு அப்புறமா அதனுடைய இம்பாக்ட் வந்து we could see that in Tamil Nadu assembly election also. For example, அரவக்குறிச்சியில அந்த பல்லப்பட்டி இந்த ஒரு வில்லேஜ்ல இந்த மாதிரி ஒரு பேனர்ஸ் கூட வச்சிருந்தாங்க. இந்த மாதிரி ஆர்டிகல் 370 அபாலிஷ் பண்ணி தே ஹவ் டன் எ வெரி பெரிய சீன் வந்து ஏற்படுத்திட்டாங்கன்ற மாதிரி பெரிய பயங்கர மாசம் ஆட் பண்ணியிருந்தாங்க. ஸோ இதை வந்து நம்ம எதுவுமே கிளியர் பண்ணவும் முடியல. பட் வாட் பெஸ்ட் இஸ் கோயிங் ஆன் ஆன் பிஹாப் ஆஃப் இந்தியான்றது வி ஆர் நாட் ஏபிள் டு சே டைரக்ட்லி நினைக்கிறேன். அது நம்ம எங்கேயுமே கொண்டு வர முடியல இன் ஃபியூச்சர்.
You are absolutely right. I just
Bipin ji, can you repeat in English, then you'll go for answer because people are there who
don't. Sumati ji, Sumati Akka understands English, so I'll only reply in English. What Sumati Akka was asking is that the issue of Article 370 had its repercussions and reflections even in Tamil Nadu Assembly Constituency of Aravan Kuruchi, where a Muslim community dominated area. They were talking about you have done injustice by removing Article 370.
Yes, yes.
So let me tell you, I mentioned it. Islam is the biggest elephant in the room. So the Islamic Brotherhood feeling is quite strong among Muslims around the world. So you know that you cannot help at all. That will continue. People think you have done some great injustice. If I don't know if you know about it, Punjab has created a new district in Muksar as headquarters. It's actually a Muslim dominated. It's another Malappuram that has been created in Punjab, and it's not too far away from the border, just less than 150 kilometers from the border. So these are all breeding grounds for ISI agents to work. So they will work. So this will
but
this
we should sort take of, some stern action against the, all such things. No?
In fact,
even Malappuram, the whole thing looks like it's being in Pakistan. The way they address, the way they take the oath, everything. But we are not doing anything for that.
Correct. What I mentioned about Pakistan's propaganda against India, particularly on Kashmir around the world, I feel very sad and it's very unfortunate. I feel sad to say this. the Indian government has not been able to counter this propaganda effectively.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Effectively till date. Mm-hmm. So we have failed. Indian government has failed in doing an effective propaganda. So I am aware that after the Modi government came to power, I think it was sometime in 2016 or 17. I think it was 2016. So the Indian government had formulated some idea. No, 2014 they came to power, but what I'm telling you now happened sometime in 2016. Yeah. So there was a group of ministers, an informal group of ministers, which discussed an idea of creating a propaganda machinery, basically, to counter this Pakistani propaganda on Kashmir. So that it was discussed, but unfortunately, that idea did not take shape. It did not become a policy or an instrument that they could use. They wanted to set up, do something, which never happened. I'm not going to discuss the details because it was a confidentially discussed. I'm just sharing that some ideas were discussed, but it never put into implementation. That was the biggest problem. So that is unfortunate. We can't help it. Basically, what finally happened was that the cost of implementing that idea was too huge. That was the final opinion that they came to.
But my
feeling is that no cost is too huge in safeguarding the interests of India.
Yes, absolutely.
So unfortunately, the government thinks on budgetary terms. So that is where the problem lies. I hope someday the ideas come out and they implement it. Well, I'm aware of it, but I can't
help. This thing continues, we have to provoke a war inside our country. It shouldn't happen. Right?
We should put pressure. The people of this country, people of who think about national interest, people like us are the ones who should put pressure on the government to do it. So anybody has any question? Dr. Brahmaya, I think I answered your question. Murthy ji, you want to ask? You are still on mute. Yeah.
You have answered. Sir, what I am trying to ask in question, like after abrogation of Article 370, how the mindset of the people of Jammu and Kashmir has been changed, sir?
Yeah. So see,
what is their perception on Indian state and what is their approach on peaceful negotiations, sir?
Yeah. So a majority of people of Kashmir region, Kashmir is a Muslim majority area. A majority of people in Kashmir region are against Article 370 scrapping, as I mentioned earlier. Okay. So the mindset of a few people in Jammu and Kashmir, including some Muslims in Kashmir area, they have changed. They are in favor of scrapping of Article 370, but the number is a minuscule minority. It is going to take us a long, like Sumatiyaka asked, we need to do a lot of propaganda. I mean, I won't call it as propaganda, but we should make a lot of effort of interaction with the people there to change their mindset. So that I think can be done, but it is a long haul task.
Yes, sir.
A long shot. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Murthy ji, you want to ask a question? You should unmute yourself and ask.
Yes, sir. I think finally, sir, Indian state has adopted the policy of democratic federalism to resolve the Jammu and Kashmir issue, sir.
Yeah. That is the way to move forward.
Yes, sir. Why? Because I have taken Jammu and Kashmir as one of the case study for my thesis, sir. So that's why, so extensively I also worked on that one. So that's why your lecture, in fact, it has immensely benefited me, sir. Thank you very much, sir. I'm happy to be of use to you. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah. Murthy ji, please, now it's your opportunity. You have to unmute yourself. I'm not able to hear you. Or you want to type out your question? If you type out, I'll take it up. Amurthy, please go ahead. No, I'm still not able to hear you. Okay, is there any other question anybody else wants to ask something before Murthy ji types out this question?
Hello, good evening, sir.
Yeah, Bodhendra, please.
Myself, Bodhendra. I would like to congratulate you for such an excellent presentation.
Thank you.
Sir, as we see, this crisis in Jammu and Kashmir has never been a local crisis. So, can you please give insight about the relationship of India and the United States of America? And what is US policy regarding this Jammu and Kashmir crisis? Whether it is in favor of India or Pakistan, because we see that US policy towards Pakistan is also
it keeps changing.
A peculiar kind.
Yeah.
So can you please give us insight?
After that, it became international because of Pakistan's aggression on Kashmir.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that is one part of the issue. The second issue that you asked is about the United States' stance on Pakistan, on Kashmir rather.
Yes.
And its relationship with India on the Kashmir issue. Mm-hmm. See, what has happened is Democrats have always been anti-India as far as Kashmir is concerned. The present government, represented by Biden and Kamala Harris, is not in favor of India as far as Kashmir is concerned. But, okay, but they won't interfere. They won't interfere in the matter for the simple reason that they think it is a bilateral issue that needs to be settled between India and Pakistan.
Mm-hmm.
Trump was a Republican president, and he was a crazy man. Let us admit it. So he offered to be an intermediary between India and Pakistan on 3 or 4 occasions.
Mm-hmm.
At least 2 occasions that I know of. Okay, that was never done in international politics and in diplomacy. Unless the host countries ask for help, you don't offer to mediate in talks. So, Trump being Trump, so it was a true Trumpism. So, that is where it stands. But only change that Trump brought about in its policy was on Pakistan. The US policy in Pakistan. He continued with Obama's policy and made it more stringent of being anti-Pakistan as far as its actions in Jammu and Kashmir and against India is concerned. So he stopped, primarily because the fight against war on terror, as he called it. The war on terror in Afghanistan was being funded by US. But unfortunately, Pakistan misused that funds to use weapons that were given to fight the war on terror against the Indian army. So the Obama administration first stopped funding Pakistan, and Trump completely stopped funding Pakistan. So we should give credit to Trump for that decision. Fortunately, Biden government has not reversed that decision. So that decision continues. But let us not think that Biden administration is in favor of India. We would be doing a huge mistake if we think that way.
We expected more after Kamala Harris has come back.
Kamala Harris was totally against India on the issue of Kashmir.
Yeah, no, but it's unfortunate.
It
and moreover, at one junction, our Modi ji told that we are least bothered about US interference about our J&K issue.
Correct. Correct.
It's like our inner family problem.
That is right. Now, that is when they stopped interfering. That is when Kamala Harris and Biden, once she became vice president, she stopped talking about Kashmir.
Yes.
But still, till the time she became vice president, she was hammering India on Kashmir issue continuously. And that is where the conflict happened between Kamala Harris and Jay Shankar, when Jay Shankar had visited, visited the US. So, then as foreign secretary. Not as external affairs minister.
Yes.
It's a small correction that I want to make.
Okay. Okay. That was really nice, sir.
Thank you, Bhosindra. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
It's a pleasure interacting with all of you. I'm happy
it
to
is
see.
Certainly.
I see a lot of academics here. So it's academicians here. So I'm happy to interact with you. So it's always a pleasure interacting with people who are completely into academics. Because they study subject without getting emotionally involved. That is important.
Yes, yes. So one thing, can I ask you a personal question?
Yeah, please.
So what do you personally feel? Do we really want to solve this problem, this Kashmir issue?
Yes, India certainly wants to solve this problem, but Pakistan doesn't want it to happen.
So there is conflict of interest.
I'll tell you why. There is a conflict of interest. If the Kashmir issue is resolved, then the Pakistan army has no reason to exist. And Pakistan army is the one which is controlling the civilian government of the, you might have heard of this joke. So every country has an army, but here the army has a country.
Country, yes.
Pakistan. So that is the fact. So there, the complete existence will be struck down. So they won't allow it to happen. So this conflict will remain.
Yes, yes, yes. So we can infer that this problem will be perpetuating for a very long time.
Very long time, till the time Pakistan exists on the face of the earth.
Yeah, certainly.
If Pakistan breaks into pieces or a nation called Pakistan doesn't exist, then the issue is resolved completely.
And I believe Pakistan is an ideology. Though it is a state, but
you're
as we said,
right.
It's an ideology and you're it's difficult
right.
to kill an idea, isn't it?
Correct. Pakistan is an idea, you are right. I agree
it's
with you on
idea.
That. Yes.
Let us see. Our coming generations have to manage it rightly.
Yeah, I'm just typing my email ID and my phone number.
Yeah.
If any of you require it, please, you can use it to get in touch with me for any.
Certainly.
I'm
yes,
just
yes.
typing it out for you.
That will be very good, sir. Fine.
Okay, my phone number and my email
Modi
ID
ji.
Is there.
Yes, yes, yes.
Modi ji.
We have Murthy ji's question. He's asking... China is building pressure on India. I mentioned that China is building pressure on India. Since you are a defense expert, I want to know, in case war from two fronts, what would be our strategy? Okay, that is one question. Okay. Thank you, Brahmaji. Thank you for your comment. Okay, Murthyji, to answer your question, if I was an astrologer, then I would be able to answer this question much more easily. But I'm not. So, what will be your strategy? We will fight it. I think that is the only answer I can give you. The Indian armed forces are completely...
Do we have any option, G?
They are aware of this threat, and because of which they are doing preparation for the last at least 10 years now that I am aware of. They have done a lot of exercises. They have done a lot of war gaming. They have done a lot of strategizing on two front war. Well, what is the strategy? I won't be able to discuss it here in a public forum. And but I can assure you that the Indian Armed Forces have a strategy.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, I think that would be enough for you.
Sure, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for your questions, Brahmaji, Bodendra, Murthy, Nagalingamji.
Sir, can I ask you a question? If Chandan
ji, thank you for all the
suddenly it has popped out into my mind. Sir, do you really think in today's world we require armed war? Since as technological changes are taking place, we have biological warfare and economic implications. So do you think going into a physical violent war is a viable solution?
Conventional war would continue. The weapon that will be used in the conventional war might change. As you rightly pointed out, there are technological developments that are happening.
Mm-hmm.
But there will be a physical war. Like, for example, this recent war that happened, Armenia, not Pakistan, Armenian war that happened.
Mm-hmm.
There was use of drones to wipe out the enemy territory, enemies, tanks and artillery guns and everything. But ultimately, if somebody wants to go and occupy that land, then you would need foot soldiers. For annexation, you would need foot soldiers.
But these days, we are encountering cyber attacks and other kind of attacks which are not visible to naked eye.
They're all unconventional warfare. They're all unconventional warfare. They are the future war that you are talking about. So that will happen.
It's present. It's present.
It is already happening.
It's happening.
It's
happening.
The war is on. It is not. There is no peace.
And 24/7, it is there.
There is no peace at this point in time in the world. It is war. It's a world war that is happening already, but it is not happening in the physical domain. It's happening in the cyber domain.
Exactly.
Even space warfare is conventional warfare, for your information.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
If you have, say, missiles, space-based weapons, then it becomes a conventional war. So, conventional war will happen. We cannot wish away conventional war despite technological advances. The person who operated the UAV, the drones, which took out the tanks and artillery in the recent war that happened. This is a 2020-21 war. You know about it. So in the Armenian war, it was basically a man behind a machine was operating those drones. Right? There is a human intervention at every stage. So it's part of conventional war.
Mm-hmm. It's the discussion is getting more interesting now, but we have time constraints.
We'll discuss it in another time. So it's fine.
Because we have advent of AI now, and human beings.
AI is still far ahead. It's not yet implemented in warfare. It's still far ahead. In simplistic terms, what is AI? AI is basically like if I give you an example. Sumati ji will like this example very much. Suppose, say, you are buying tomatoes and potatoes every day for your kitchen, or say once a week for your kitchen, you put it in your refrigerator. When you start using the tomato and the potatoes, the AI will tell you that, okay, it's time for you to fill up that potato bag or the tomato bag. That is AI. To put it in simple terms.
Even AI is not just, I would like to add.
No,
AI can convince you to buy brinjal. It can convince you to buy chicken.
Yes, that is provided it has intelligence that today I'm going to make some biryani at home. Then it will tell me all this. Buy some carrot. It will give me instructions.
Yes.
Go buy some carrot, buy some beans. You're going to do biryani today, so buy all that. That is
energy.
But it should
nice. Yes, sir.
Nice it should have that intelligence that I'm going to make biryani today.
Just
to for
Senthil ji can control. Can control.
Yes.
I personally thanks to Bibin ji. Good interaction session with prominent person here. All the 10 people are prominent person. I think maybe these people are future our guest lecture in these sessions also. Personally, thanks to Bibin ji and Senthil Kumar ji and all other participation to everyone too. I thank you so much.
I also personally want to thank Senthil ji, Gangadharan, and each one of you personally, because only by asking questions that you force me to think. So that way I'm also learning. For that reason, thank you so much. Thanks for this opportunity.
Thank you, JD.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you for this wonderful evening.
Thank you.